Recorded Books presents A Guide to the Dark by Meriam Metoui, narrated by Vaneh Assadourian, Ariana Delawari, and Ramiz Monsef.
No one ever told me that grief felt so like fear. C.S. Lewis. 1. It was only a room at the time. There was nothing about it that Peter found out of place. Eerie. Wrong. It was only a room in a motel, in a city he never planned on coming back to. A fleeting memory, if one at all. But Peter Greenwell had the unfortunate honor of being the first. When the phone rang, Peter was in the shower. He stood beneath the hot water, hoping it would calm his quick heartbeat. He had been waiting for this call, dreading it. Either way, it was inevitable, and so he shut off the water and readied himself to face what he could no longer avoid. But as his foot found the cold tile, and his hand reached for the towel with Wildwood Motel embroidered near the edge, Peter slipped. He scrambled for a moment, trying to find something to grab onto, but the towel slid away from the hook, and his other hand grasped only air. It all happened quicker than he thought it would. There was no time to reflect or slow down. No time for one uneventful life to flash through Peter Greenwell's mind. His head made contact with the porcelain sink, and he sank to the floor. The blood and water like tendrils delicately painting the life that seeped out of him. It was 1978, only 2 years after the motel had first opened its dozen rooms. 12 years later, Lola Moreno was next. She was only looking for some quiet, a day or two away, when she realized too late that she might be able to escape her life but not her mind. Next came Eugene McDaniel, 9 years after that, a retired teacher on his way to visit two grandchildren who had all but forgotten him. And on it went, all the way to a Noah Davis, only 4 months prior, who knew of every death that had come before, and the part he had played in many of them. Room 9's history was dark and rotten, and had a way of sinking into its guests. Their deaths within it were unfortunate in the same way. They all came too close to the flame, and when that happens, the fire takes care of the rest. Tonight is no different.
2. Layla. We were supposed to drive straight to Chicago, but it was pouring, the windshield an indecipherable picture of the road ahead. The rain had started 10 minutes ago in one of those torrential downpours that appear out of nowhere. Mira slowed down, her shoulders scrunched over the steering wheel as she tried to make sense of where the lane was. It didn't help that we had taken the wrong exit a while back, and my phone was refusing to cooperate. 5 bars my ass. The map app refused to load no matter how many times I restarted it. I think we need to pull over and wait this out, Mira. I'm pretty sure it's only getting worse. Mira squinted at the windshield, her brow furrowed, and then her eyes went wide. A small gasp escaped her lips before she quickly twisted the steering wheel to the right. I couldn't see what Mira swerved to avoid, but by then it didn't matter. The tire skidded across the road, farther than she had planned. It happened faster than either of us expected. My seatbelt yanked me back, firm and sharp against my collarbone, as the car spun. It made a full turn before it slipped past the pavement and landed in a ditch, the front bumper resting against the wet dirt at an angle. On impact, the opening of the airbag compartment snapped against the windshield and shattered the glass, 1,000 cracks branching out at once. Seconds later, I could feel my raw skin burn with the sudden friction of the seatbelt. The sound of rain pounding against the roof filled the small space as the smell of burnt rubber and smoke wafted in. "Layla? Layla, are you okay?" Mira said. There was a quiet hum, low and steady, but I couldn't tell if it was the car or in my head. I nodded, wanting to say more but managing only that. I looked back at her, relieved that she seemed fine. There was a trail of blood down her temple, dark against her skin. "You're bleeding," I said, reaching toward her. She looked up at the rearview mirror between us and wiped it with the back of her hand. "I'm fine. I feel fine, I promise." She smiled at me, small and reassuring, and got out to inspect the damage. The rain was loud and heavy on the windshield, but I could make out the shape of her against the car headlights. She crouched to get a better look. Even if she did have a handle on things, I felt bad watching her get drenched. It was only fair that I join her. I stepped out of the car, and my flats immediately sank into the mud. This night clearly wasn't done with me yet. I trudged over to Mira, wondering how she managed to look so graceful. "I thought I saw someone, but..." She paused, squinting through the rain. "There's nothing here." I bent down to study the car. This looked bad. Like stranded in the middle of nowhere bad. The right headlight was cracked, though the main bulb still shone through. The windshield had shattered, a spider web at the bottom spreading outward, and a flat front right tire surrounded a bent rim. There was no way Kira was drivable. We barely knew how to change a tire, if knowing in theory even counted, and this was beyond us. We were going to die out here, weren't we? Some serial killer was going to spot us on his nightly stroll, and that would be the end of us. I hoped it would be quick. "You don't have to say it. We're screwed," Mira said. The storm was letting up, but she looked at the sky and let the rain continue to drench her long brown curls. Her leather jacket was open, and the visible part of her gray top was soaked through, the edges of her bra outlined against the thin t-shirt. "This is fine. We're totally fine, just fine." My pitch rose with every word. She raised an eyebrow and smiled at my rising panic, squinting through the thinning rain. "I'm going to go call a tow truck or something," she said. She went back inside the car, the rain now a mist, gone as quickly as it had come. I sat down at the edge of the road where the grass met the pavement and lay back, letting my dress soak through. What was the point of anything? We were nearing the end of our college tour spring break best friend road trip, which had been one perfectly memorable and adventure-filled week. No parents, no school, no younger sisters constantly breathing down my neck, just Mira and me and the open road. But we'd crashed the car in the middle of nowhere, would miss tonight's hotel reservation, and had little chance of making it to tomorrow's undergraduate portfolio day at the School of the Art Institute of Chicago, what would have been the highlight of the trip. Only second to spending it with Mira, of course. The 10 years older version of me that's photographing magazine covers and working on editorial shoots was fading with each passing second. I thought of my portfolio, carefully tucked away in my bag. They'd never see it now. My best shot at getting off their wait list, gone. I might as well take it out and let the rain soak through the thick paper. Let the ink run together until the photographs were an unintelligible mess. Mira slammed the car door and made her way over. Our height difference felt even more exaggerated as she stood over me. Droplets fell from her sharp jaw and landed near my mud-soaked shoes. She handed me my camera bag and stretched out next to me, letting the wet grass soak through her jeans. "Thought you might be worried about your baby, sturdy little thing," she said. I hugged the bag to my chest and took out the camera to inspect. "Thank you, past me, for actually putting it away after our last shoot in Nashville." I stood up and took a test shot just in case, framing the wrecked car in the center and letting the beams flare against the lens. I sighed in relief. Everything seemed to be working, The edge of the light took on an odd shape, but it must have been the bright headlights playing against the lens. At least one thing wasn't entirely and irrevocably ruined. "Kira looks like a goner," I said, studying the tilt of Mira's car against the mud. "Nah, she's sturdy too. She'll pull through." She took a deep breath and let the mist dampen her skin. She had her hazel eyes closed, her head tilted back, the edge of a smile on her lips. I snapped a quick photo of her bathed in the car headlights and turned off the camera. Mira deserved this trip more than anyone. After the shit year she'd had, home was anything but. Things were different since Khalil, her brother, died. She was different. The Mira who laughed too quickly and loved too hard was gone. In her place was an impulsive, more anxious Mira, one who was quieter than before, at least with me. I saw how she put on a face for others, like she was squeezing into something too small, trying to shove down parts of herself she didn't want others to see. I couldn't fix any of it, and I didn't know how to make her feel better. All I did was worry. Aside from Khalil, I didn't know anyone who had died. I couldn't know what she was feeling, could only guess at that sort of grief. But I hoped this trip would at least serve as a temporary distraction. It was part of the reason I pushed so hard for us to be here. But here, wherever here was, wasn't exactly the plan. "Tow truck will be here soon," she said when she heard me sit back down. "Thanks for making the call." She squeezed my hand in response, and my heart fluttered just the tiniest bit. I was a little in love with Mira Hamdi. Not that Mira, or anyone for that matter, knew. I was a little in love with the way she always took control of the situation. Whenever I thought of myself as the calm, cool under pressure one, she swooped in and saved the day. Like when I twisted my ankle in gym last semester, or when I forgot my film camera in her car over one hot summer weekend. Both times, Mira quickly quelled the tide of panic that threatened to flood over. I was a little in love with the way she laughed at the punchline of every joke I made, before I made it, because she knew exactly what I was thinking. God, I loved her laugh. I loved making her laugh. What a fleeting high it was to hear it. I was a little in love with how her soft skin felt beneath mine right now. But Mira didn't know any of that. So I pulled away and sat up, looking for a tow truck heading toward us.
3. Mira.
"The motel's just down this little gravel road. Can't miss it," the driver said as the tow truck slowed to a stop.
"Can you drive us the rest of the way, though?" Layla asked. She looked confused in the dim overhead light.
"I would rather not," was all the man said. "Good luck."
"Thanks," I said, though it came out as more of a question. I pulled open the door handle and jumped outside.
When I offered a hand to Layla, she jumped down on her own, holding the hem of her wet, pale green dress as she leapt. We took our bags from the cab of his truck. A red backpack and brown leather duffel for me, a camera bag and a small yellow rolling suitcase for her.
"It's a small town,"
the tow truck driver leaned forward to say.
"Most of it within walking distance. Come by the garage tomorrow and Bill, the mechanic, will let you know the damage. Good night, ladies."
He smiled reassuringly and drove off. "Ready?" Layla nodded and we headed down the road. She seemed quiet, a little lost in thought as we fell out of step, which felt odd considering Layla always had something to say. Her long, dark hair fell in soft waves, covering her face. She tucked one side behind her ear, still damp from the rain. I could see she was concentrating, focused on pulling her rolling suitcase along. She was only shorter than me by a few inches, but I wanted to wrap her in a bear hug and tell her that the car would be fine tomorrow morning, that we would make it to the portfolio day in Chicago in time,
that the admissions department would love her photos and admit her on the spot, standard procedure be damned. But we both knew we weren't going to make it in time, so there was no use lying to her. Finally, we saw the motel, a long, one-level building that had seen better days. An orange neon sign that read, Wildwood Motel, hummed above the center, which was a story higher than the rest. Beneath it, two signs that read, Office and Vacancy, flickered. I led us toward the signs, but slowed down to let Layla catch up. Her suitcase really wasn't built for gravel.
Almost there, she said through gritted teeth.
She paused and took a deep breath.
You know what? Go on without me. I'll catch up in a minute.
You sure? She sat down on top of her suitcase and nodded, stretching both legs out in front of her. Nothing would move Layla now. I stepped inside and pushed the door open with my back, heaving my duffel bag toward the foot of the front desk with both hands. Hi, I said to the two people behind it. It seemed like I had interrupted their conversation, but they both chuckled, amused by my graceful entrance, I'm sure. I got this, Izzy. The boy sitting on the high top chair said as he adjusted his round glasses. You can go help my mom if you want. She looked like she was in her early 20s. Black linework tattoos adorned her left arm. I marveled at them for a second, studying the way they flowed in and out of one another as they melted into her brown skin. She narrowed her eyes at him and nodded.
Mm-hmm, sure I can. I'll be in the back if you need anything, she told him and left.
How can I help you? He asked as he moved his open book aside. I would love a room for me and my friend.
No problem.
He turned to his computer and began typing. My eyes lit up when I noticed his t-shirt. I love Alabama shakes. He looked up at me, confused, but smiled and said,
Me too.
I gestured at his band t-shirt until he finally connected the dots.
Oh, he smiled. That makes more sense than you randomly sharing that information.
I have the same t-shirt. Got it when I saw them live in Detroit. We should have coordinated.
If only we hadn't met 30 seconds ago.
He threw his hands up in fake anger and laughed. He had a nice laugh, soft and full. Just then, Layla opened the office door and kicked her suitcase inside, where it landed on its back. She gently removed her camera bag from her right shoulder and set it on top. The boy watched with wide eyes. He stood up, wondering if he should help, but Layla looked angry, and I didn't blame him for reconsidering. She nodded at him, her lips in a tight line.
What name should I put this under?
Mira Hamdi. He glanced at me then, just for a second, as if consciously committing face and name to memory.
Where are you guys coming from?
Ann Arbor, Michigan, I guess. Technically, the last city we were in was Nashville, but I figured he was asking us where we were from.
One night?
He asked, turning back to the computer. Layla and I looked at each other. Ideally, sure, we'd be back on the road by tomorrow, but we'd both seen the car. This seemed unlikely. For now, our car broke down and we're here until it's fixed.
Oof, that sucks, he said.
He wove his hand through his hair to keep it at bay and focused on the screen. He seemed to be our age, give or take. He was lean, about my height, white, with dark, expressive eyebrows that were knitted together. I couldn't help but notice the sharp line of his jaw and the way his deep brown eyes squinted at something he saw. The boy looked up, studying us. It looked like he was trying to make up his mind about something.
I'm really sorry, but we're actually booked. There's a bed and breakfast in town.
You might have better luck there, he said, his voice low. Layla sighed behind me, clearly already dreading the walk into town with her suitcase. Thanks anyway, I said. I wondered if they'd mind us lying down in their parking lot for the night. I wasn't sure either of us would make it into town at this point. As we turned to leave, a woman emerged from the back room, a warm smile spread across her face.
Ellis, honey, check again.
These young ladies shouldn't have to trek all the way to Janet's place this late. I'm sure we have something available.
Mom, there's nothing, he told her. They stared at each other until his mom finally broke the silence.
Check again, she said, her smile a little forced now.
Finally, he glanced back at the computer. Looks like room 9 is open. Two keys?
Yes, I said. Layla looked at me, confused. You and me both, girl.
Here you go. Will that be cash or card?
He was avoiding eye contact now, busying himself with something on his screen. I handed over my emergency credit card. If this wasn't the time to use it, I didn't know what was. He slid it through the card reader and quickly handed it back.
Please enjoy your stay.
He placed two keys on the counter and stood, walking past his mom and up the stairs on the back wall. She smiled at us and straightened the pamphlets on the desk.
There's a conference in the city this week, so it's been very busy around here. And with another booking earlier today and now room 9, we're fully booked,
the mom said with a grin. She couldn't hide her excitement.
That's great. Glad we can be the final guests, I said. I'm Elena, by the way. Shout if you need anything.
Will do. Have a nice night,
Layla said pointedly, ready to end the conversation. We gathered our things and headed toward the room, counting down the numbers along the right side of the building. I turned to make sure Layla was behind me and found her a few feet away, looking through her viewfinder. She clicked, and the sound of the shutter seemed louder in the quiet. The second we were inside, Layla walked toward one of the beds, the one closest to the bathroom, and threw herself on top, shedding her bags and jacket as she went.
Tired already?
I asked, smiling. She mumbled something into the mattress but made no effort to move. Objectively, the room wasn't as bad as I thought it would be. Two sets of sheer and beige blackout curtains lined the window behind me. The dark red carpet hid any stains it most likely held, and a small TV sat opposite the two twin beds. But it also felt, well, I'm not sure what it felt like, just that I felt heavy in it, weighed down by something outside of me. The room felt small, the air thin. My heart sped up as if preparing me for something I couldn't see. I'm going to get some fresh air, I said. She gave me a thumbs up from her bed and let her arm drop with a soft thud. The spring air felt good in my lungs, cool and brisk. I could swear it was different here, fuller. There wasn't much to do but wonder, and so I found myself turning the corner of the motel. In the distance, I could see a pool glistening, blue and bright from the lights beneath the surface. My lungs suddenly felt tighter, like the April air had seeped out of them without my noticing. I fought it back and headed toward the pool. The lounge chair was damp from the rain, and so I laid out my leather jacket and sat on top, near the edge, keeping a safe distance from the water. Almost a year later, and I still couldn't look at a pool, or lake, or ocean, or any body of water, really, without having to remind myself to breathe. I twisted in the chair and kept my back to the pool. No use in dredging up memories best kept buried. No, there were other things to focus on, like how my parents would see the motel charge on their credit card and wonder why we were here. It was off the pre-approved itinerary, and though I doubted they would care too much, it was best to avoid the possible situation entirely. I took out my phone and pulled up the group chat with my parents. Car broke down in Wildwood, Indiana. Staying in town until the car is fixed. We're okay. I clicked send and put my phone away. I imagined my mom seeing the text in the morning, once her daily dose of sleeping pills had worn off, of course. She'd glance at it, maybe toy with the idea of calling to see if I was okay, but would ultimately abandon that thought to spend a few more hours refusing to leave her bed. I could count the times she'd left her room in the past year on one hand. My dad, on the other hand, had abandoned the idea of sleep entirely. When I asked why he was always up, he said,
Felt like we needed some balance around here.
He said it jokingly, smiling. But the smile never reached his eyes, and he was quiet after that. It had been quiet at home for a long time now, and if I was being honest, it was part of the reason I jumped at the chance when Layla suggested this trip. Anything was worth taking a week away from that stifling silence. From walking past Khalil's closed door or sharing a bathroom with nothing but his absence. A year later and none of us had the heart to throw out his toothbrush. Maybe I was running from his memory, but I was good at running. This entire trip was planned around our college acceptances and Layla's one waitlist. I was most likely choosing the University of Chicago after a campus tour a few months ago. Seeing the other stops was just necessary confirmation of what I already knew. Sure, my major was undecided at the moment, but that campus, the city, it just felt right. Plus, leaving home was a necessity at this point. I didn't know how much longer I could stand living under the same roof as two parents who sat so deep in their own grief that they left no room for anything else. Layla, though, didn't have the same certainty. Her parents expected her to stay close to home at the University of Michigan, where the in-state tuition was reasonable. Her acceptance had hung on the fridge since the day it arrived. She hadn't even told them about her scholarship to Parsons School of Design in New York. "Why start a fight over something I haven't even made a decision on?" she'd said. Once we came back from the trip, she promised she would tell them. If she decided on leaving, that is. My parents, on the other hand, had abandoned me. I could have told them I was going on this trip by leaving them a vague note. "Off to see the world. Be back soon." And they might not have thought twice about it. I almost wished I had, just to see what they would have done. We had left Ann Arbor 6 days ago and begun a 9-hour drive to New York City. The next day, we toured Parsons and visited NYU's scattered buildings through Greenwich Village. We ended it with a chilly picnic at Washington Square Park before we started the short drive to D.C. Georgetown felt like it had always existed, like the rest of the city was merely built around it. Then came Nashville, which was everything D.C. wasn't, loud and vibrant. We spent our one night there listening to a band we hadn't heard before and dancing until our legs begged us to go back to the hotel. After a day, we looped around and started heading toward Chicago before ending up here, in good old Wildwood, Indiana. Not exactly the detour we had in mind, but things could be worse. It was getting late, and tomorrow would most likely be a long day. I grabbed my jacket and was heading back toward the room when I saw the front desk boy, Ellis, making his way toward the pool. I waved when we were close enough, but he seemed to hesitate before saying goodnight. "Night," I said, and kept walking. Odd. But the night's events were finally catching up with me, and the only thing I had mental space for was sleep. I gently closed the door behind me. The room was dark except for a single lamp between the two beds and a smaller motel sign that shone through the window. Layla was fast asleep. At least she had changed into her pajamas and made it under the covers. Her hair fanned out around her pillow, dark as night around her brown skin. I got changed, climbed into bed, and turned off the lamp that she must have kept on for me. But in the sudden darkness, I saw a silhouette of a man standing in the middle of the parking lot. The shape of him made of the orange neon light that fell down from the sign above. I couldn't tell if he was watching us or was turned away, but as far as he was, I could feel his gaze like a tangible thing. It was a third person in the room, bigger than either of us. Every part of me ached to reach over and pull the curtains closed, but instead I lay there, still as he was.
Tuesday. 4. The girl stares at the parted curtains, afraid to blink. A figure stands in the middle of the parking lot, unmoving. She can swear the figure, tall and broad-shouldered, is facing them, watching her and her friend. But it is dark, and the only light that comes through is from the motel sign that glows bright and orange in the night. All she can make out is his silhouette and the light that surrounds him, like the edges of him are burning. She does not understand why his innocuous presence unnerves her, just that it does. Finally, after one long minute, the man walks away. The girl, broken from her spell, quickly pulls the curtains closed and lies back down. The girl twists in bed, trying to find sleep, to tuck the memory of him away. Eventually, she drifts. Here is where the fun begins. The girl tumbles into sleep, messy and restless, but eventually the dream forms. The pull begins. People tend to hide things, even from themselves, feelings, memories. Other people. They keep them in their darkest corners, and when a light shines through, these demons have no choice but to come clamoring out. The dream begins in darkness. True darkness. The kind that makes you doubt if your body has ever existed. Have you always been a voice, suspended in nothing? Little by little, pieces take shape. The water is first. It is sudden, and it is everywhere. There is no up or down, no direction. The pull goes deeper, tugging at a particularly restless thought. Slowly, that too forms. A shape surrounds the girl inside the water. First limbs and torso, then a face that is too blurry to make out. The girl fights to keep it at bay. She does not want to see this, not yet. The limbs tighten around her. The arms push against her head. It sends her deeper into murky waters. The girl's lungs are burning. She wakes with a start. The girl holds her hands to her chest and takes deep breaths. Her lungs can't seem to fill with enough air. She stays that way for a few seconds, sucking in as much as her body will allow. She can't seem to slow down her racing pulse. Eventually, she makes her way to her friend's bed and folds herself next to her. The friend mumbles in sleep and shifts over, making room for the girl. Their bodies are puzzle pieces. Her pulse slows down, but she can't shake the dream or the feelings it has stirred up. She can sense something beneath her surface, clawing to get out.
5. Layla. Mira had her arm around my waist. I repeat, Mira had her arm around my waist. I didn't know what unlikely miracle had happened last night, but I was thankful for it. She was still asleep, her breath soft and steady, but she had her arm draped over my side, and the heat of it could set me on fire. Slowly, I turned over and looked at her. Her olive skin seemed to glow where the streaks of sunlight landed. Sometimes it was nice to pretend we were more than we were. Obviously, I knew she loved me. We were best friends. That was a prerequisite to best friendship. But I wanted more. I wanted to tuck a loose caramel curl behind her ear, to brush my thumb against her soft cheek and glide it down to the scar at the edge of her jaw from a bike ride gone wrong when she was 12. I wanted to kiss her awake, for her to kiss me back. Was I being greedy? Probably. Instead, I lay in that early morning light for a minute and pretended, letting myself think friends was only the beginning for us. Being here, surrounded by the quiet of this small town and the early morning light peeking through the crack in the curtains, it felt different. We felt different. Like there was static in the air. As if the knowledge that there was no large city to distract us, no itinerary to check off, allowed us to be just us, whatever that meant. Or maybe it was all in my head. Maybe this charged quiet was of my own making. Eventually, I pulled away, gently shifting the blanket away from my side of the bed. My suitcase was open on the floor from when I'd grabbed pajamas last night. Near the top was a coral dress with a deep, wide V neckline and cloth buttons all the way down. I couldn't wear it back home without one of my parents demanding I go back to my room and change into something less haram. Here, though, no one could say shit. Ha. I buttoned up the dress, grabbed my keys and wallet, and quietly slipped away in search of food, letting the door softly click behind me. We had skipped dinner last night. The only option I could think of that didn't include hiking all the way to town was the vending machine. I scanned the options, limited, but aha, near the bottom, abandoned and most likely expired, were small glass bottles of orange juice. I pushed E7 and collected our drinks, wondering if the front desk had breakfast options. I wasn't sure what to expect in a place like this, but I felt hopeful. Yesterday may have been a shit show, but there was no reason today had to be too. "Morning," the front desk boy said when I walked in. I nodded at him and turned to spot the pastries behind me. A box of half a dozen cinnamon buns rested on the dark wooden table, the frosting still soft and oozing down the sides. "Perfect timing. They're still warm," he said. "It was either this or nothing, so thanks," I said, smiling. I turned to leave, but then he stopped me. "I'm Ellis, by the way, in case you or Mira, right? Need anything?" My smile felt forced now, like my face was frozen in this half-grimace. Of course this was about Mira. I didn't blame him, but come on, man, keep it professional. "I'm Layla, and we're good." "Cool," he said. We stared at each other for a long second, neither knowing if that was the end of the conversation. I was ready to walk out by then, but he opened his mouth and quickly closed it. After another second of this, I needed to leave. This was getting weird. "Did you guys sleep okay?" he asked. "Yeah." I didn't understand why he was trying to make conversation. "I'm going to go now, before these get cold. Thanks again," I said. And with that, I took my cinnamon buns and left. By the time I made it back to the room, Mira was up. If scrolling in my bed was up. "I have brought us a feast. No need to thank me. Sharing this spread of culinary delicacies with you is enough." Her stomach growled at the sight of cinnamon buns. "Oh my God, yes." I handed her one and sat down across from her. We ate in silence for a minute, enjoying the sunlight that slipped past the curtains. "I think the front desk boy asked about you in a roundabout way," I said between bites. It wasn't surprising. A lot of people couldn't help but be enthralled by Mira. She had this effortless way of carrying herself, like there was a gentle force inside her and all you wanted was to be pulled in by it. "Ellis," she said, smiling. "He's kind of cute, right?" "I guess. I don't know. He seems weird. Off. He asked how we slept. It felt creepy. And I meant it, but I also couldn't help the sting I felt knowing that maybe she was interested back. Mira had never been shy about dating, but I didn't need Ellis to be on the roster. This trip was about us. More than anything, I wanted it to stay that way. "Maybe he was just being nice," she said. "This place is weird, not him. I doubt many people sleep well here," she added, looking around. She seemed tense, like she was convinced something was watching her. "I don't see it. Sure, I always thought motels would be gross, but this place is sort of charming. Has this vintage vibe I'm kind of dying to capture on camera. Look at this old floral wallpaper. What is that, marigolds?" I said, studying the wall. "The green bathroom? This TV from at least 4 decades ago? It's nostalgic, like it's frozen in time or something." Mira looked confused, her drink stopping halfway to her mouth. "I don't feel that," was all she said. I noticed that the skin beneath her eyes was dark and thin. I thought she had stopped having the nightmares months ago, but maybe not. Did you have a bad dream last night? She licked the last of the icing off her thumb and kept her eyes focused on the orange juice. The glass clinked against her silver thumb ring. My matching ring rested around my pointer finger. She nodded, only slightly, and brought the OJ to her lips. Was it about Khal? I think I'm going to go for a run. Thanks for breakfast, Layla. She stood up and began rummaging through her duffel between the two beds. Wait, Mira, you sure you don't want to talk about any? I'm fine. Don't worry about me. She pulled out a t-shirt and sweatpants and left to change in the bathroom. She'd changed in front of me a million times, but I guess anything to avoid talking about her dream. She walked out of the bathroom and grabbed her phone. Curls had escaped her quick ponytail and rested on her back. I wanted to pry her feelings out of her, but I knew better than to push Mira. At least on this. She seemed different this morning, quieter. I could feel the distance she was creating between us. I didn't want to add to it. She reached for the door and paused. "Do you hear that?" she said. I stopped chewing and listened. "No, what is it?" I don't know. It sounds like waves? It sounds like the ocean." She looked paler than she did a few seconds ago. Her eyes darted around the room, trying to find the source, but I still didn't hear anything. "You okay, Mira?" "I'm fine. I'll see you later." She put on her headphones and shoved the keys into her pocket, slamming the door behind her.
6. Mira. I focused on my breathing. In, out. Felt my lungs fill and release with every step I took. I began a loop around the motel, but when that only took a few minutes, I headed into town to check up on Kira. I had gotten that beautiful, rusty 2004 Chrysler Sebring earlier this year. Sure, my parents had only bought the car for me so they didn't have to drive me anywhere, so that my mom could hole up in her room uninterrupted. But still, Kira was my most prized possession, and she was in pieces. Obviously, Layla and I were both okay, and that's what mattered most. But Kira mattered too. The cut on the edge of my hairline still felt raw. I could feel it throbbing as I pushed myself forward. I touched it, but it wasn't bleeding, just there. The farther I was from the motel, the easier it was to breathe. I didn't understand how Layla felt completely fine at the motel. She didn't feel how the air was heavier there, like the shadows hid something darker than themselves. It was like we had slept in two separate rooms, and it wasn't just the figure in the parking lot, whatever that was. Objectively, I knew that wasn't all that odd. It just felt wrong. She may have been asleep for that, but I couldn't deny the weight of that room from the moment I first stepped into it. And maybe I couldn't blame the room for my dream. If anything, that must have been the pool, being too close to water. But it had been months since I'd had drowning nightmares. I couldn't sleep for weeks after Khalil died, couldn't go anywhere without seeing him in a stranger's gate, or every time I looked in the mirror, his curly hair the same as mine, only darker. 14 was too fucking soon. The night before that trip to Tunisia, I had wandered into his room and thrown myself onto his unmade bed. He whipped around, then proceeded to ignore me, continuing to fill his suitcase with unfolded t-shirts like I wasn't there. "We leave in the morning. You told Mom you packed," I said. "Is it lying if I end up doing it eventually?" He tapped his temple, proud of his own logic. "Are you excited?" I asked him. It had been 5 years since the last trip back. Khalil was only 9 then. I was 12. He paused to think about the question. "A little bit. Mostly looking forward to spending..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.